Are you ready?
I didn't think we'd ever see this again, but after skipping a generation, AMD just proved they've still got it, baby! By building this, a high-end desktop or HEDT class CPU that makes Intel's fastest consumer chip look like a drugged donkey. That's less than half the speed. That's right, Threadripper is back and with some staggering numbers. I am talking up to 64 cores, up to a terabyte of quad-channel DDR5, and up to an eye-watering price of $5,000. And get this, that's for the plebeian consumer version. The pro lineup goes even harder. Unlike this easy segue to our sponsor. MSI. This holiday, let MSI be your personal Santa. With great deals on award-winning laptops, GPUs, and more, they've got the perfect gifts for the gamers on your list, including you. Click the link below to find out more. There's a ton to unpack here, but the lion's share of the improvements this generation come courtesy of AMD's Zen 4 architecture. It's the same one that we already know and love from Ryzen 7000 and their current EPYC lineup, but in a nutshell, it boasts an average 13% increase in instructions per clock compared to Zen 3, and delivers higher clock speeds to boot. And I'm not talking about wimpy Intel 14th gen increases either. We're talking boost clocks going up at least 500 megahertz across the board compared to the workstation-only chips that we got last gen, which means these things are going to absolutely suck. Power, that is. Especially given that they are fully unlocked, allowing you to overclock. More on that later. I mean, right now. AMD rates the quad-channel memory controller in these things for 5,200 megatransfers per second, but clearly they're encouraging you to go higher because they shipped their review kits with 128 gigs of 6,400 megatransfer per second CL32 registered ECC DDR5. For the non-memory geeks out there, that is rippin' fast. And she's loaded up with support for up to 92 lanes of PCI Express, 48 of which run at Gen 5 speeds. But enough chit-chat. Let's take her out for a rip, shall we? But what do we compare against? Threadripper Pro, which we'll talk about later, would go head-to-head with Intel's W Series Xeons, but neither Intel nor AMD have launched an HEDT product in nearly 4 years. And I guess this is why. If you're a gamer, and that's a lot of you, you probably shouldn't buy this. Across the board, you are far better off going with a, I don't even know what to call them now, low-end desktop chip? LEDT has a nice ring to it. Let's go with that. Now for giggles, Labs did try enabling gaming mode in the BIOS, and it did net some performance gains, but unfortunately, it also limited our 32 and our 64 core processor to just 16 cores each without SMT, which is AMD's version of hyperthreading. And the worst part is that every time you want to toggle this setting, it's a full system reboot. So it's not the kind of thing you can disable when it's time to get some real work done. AMD made it clear that they don't really recommend using it, and I tend to agree with them. So let's move on to productivity. By going to lttstore.com and signing up for a notification for our upcoming magnetic cable organizers. What? That's productive. Now, naturally, these new Threadripper chips, well, there's no other way to put it, they rip the threads off of the LEDT chips that we're comparing against, as long as the workloads can take advantage of all those threads. But what some might consider unnatural is how close we got to GPU numbers in some of these applications. Obviously, we'd still recommend a proper GPU for your blending needs, given the cost and power consumption factors at play, but it's still darn impressive all the same. Handbrake AV1 encoding shows a similar story with our Threadripper scaling with more cores, but only up to a point. This isn't surprising though, because while the SVT AV1 encoder used by Handbrake can scale beyond 16 or so cores, it requires you to enable features that would harm video quality, which, when you're spending this kind of money on a video encoding machine, would feel kind of silly. Moving on to Y-Cruncher, it's not a great showcase for Threadripper's price to performance, at least beyond 32 cores, but what it is a clear win for AMD overall. Their decision to support AVX 512 after Intel dropped it on their consumer chips with 12th gen is a big deal if your workload or your application happens to support it. And while there aren't a ton of those especially in the consumer space at the moment, they do exist. PlayStation 3 emulation, for example, benefits hugely, and we're expecting to see more examples of it in the future. Moving on to Spec Workstation 3.1. We did run it, if you're curious about the scores, but as it's an older benchmark, we found that it didn't scale very well with these chips, and we feel these numbers should be taken with a grain of salt. Take 7-Zip, for example. If you manually run the latest version, rather than using the one bundled in Spec, there are some serious gains as you jump up the core count ladder. Or at least gains to a point. File compression and decompression rely heavily on memory bandwidth and latency, so this could be a case where we are leaving some performance on the table, and the Pro lineup with its support for up to 8 memory channels could justify its price premium. Whatever that ends up being, we don't know yet, AMD won't tell us. But whatever it is, it also might totally not be worth it in some cases. To demonstrate, we pulled 2 sticks of memory out, limiting our non-Pro chips even further to just dual channel. And you can see here that compute-bound Blender didn't seem to mind, at least not in the scenes that we ran, while the change was very noticeable in Cinebench. For best performance then, you're almost certainly going to want to fill all 4 slots. But for prospective Pro buyers, well, they might need to carefully evaluate if they actually need more. We plan to get our hands on those chips in the future, so make sure that you're subscribed. It's worth noting that all of the tests you guys have looked at so far were run with our Threadripper chips in their out-of-the-box stock operating mode. That means they were abiding by their rated 350-watt TDP, but let's see what happens if we take them off leash. And I'm back! PBO is enabled, load line calibration is set to 3 for stability, and we've changed over to Cinebench 2024. Let's see how this goes! Look at this, we were drawing 150 watts at idle. Oh boy, we're to 250. How are we doing here? Oh, 420! Nice. 500 watts, good gravy. Look at the score though, over 6,000 points, and we got even higher without monitoring running in the background. That is 4 times the performance of an Apple M1 Ultra, and it even leaves itself, without PBO enabled, firmly in the dust, and not just in Cinebench. We reran most of our entire suite and found that this was true pretty much across the board. Except on the memory bottlenecked ones, but we already talked about that. And all it comes at is a cost of, I don't know, what have we looked at? 90 degrees Celsius on your space heater, no problem. Thankfully, cooling these chips at their rated TDP isn't too difficult, as long as you have a beefy cooler like the NZXT Kraken 360 that we were using on our bench. We're gonna have that, along with everything else we've shown, linked down below. The reason for that is while these chips are still outputting as much thermal energy or heat as a 14900K, which is notoriously difficult to cool when it's boosting to its max, the core temperatures are more manageable because that heat is spread across a larger surface area. And this is really easy to understand when we compare the 7980X, the 64 core, to its little brother.
But Linus, they're the same size.
Yes, but the 7970X has only 4 CCDs, or core compute dies, under that same size heat spreader. So almost all of that 350 watts comes from here, 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 and here. By comparison, the 7980X has 8 CCDs, doubling the core count, and also effectively doubling the surface area at that same 350 watts. That's why the 7980X unintuitively runs so much cooler. At least, until you start overclocking. Then you better get some serious cooling for this mama jama. Which brings us to the most serious part of our little chat today, the price. Even considering the cost of previous Threadripper generations, these new chips are spectacularly expensive. And this isn't helped by the cost of the accompanying platform. There are 2 chipsets launching alongside these processors, WRX 90 and TRX 50 for the Pro and the HEDT chips respectively. And we're expecting pricing to start for these motherboards at around $1,000 US. Add to that, that non-Pro now requires ECC memory, which it didn't used to, and it's pretty clear to me that the days of, yeah, Baldur's Gate 3 isn't gonna use all these cores, but my trust fund doesn't mind, are pretty much over. These CPUs are so not for gamers that the word game wasn't even included in the press release announcing them. If you only occasionally need many cores, the reality of it is LEDT has you covered, and AMD knows that, clearly. However, that doesn't mean we hate the idea of this product altogether. The hardware is obviously super cool, and I nerd out over this stuff. And it might even be practical. Let's say you're an AI developer, or you have a daily need for virtualization, or you run a visual effects studio. If you can save a few minutes of every hour because yours, or who knows, your entire team's render finishes a bit faster, well, time is money, baby. And a $2,500 or even $5,000 CPU could pay for itself faster than you'd think. And hey, if it can also game off hours, so much the better. But here's the rub. Now that HEDT, if our guesses are accurate, is priced closer to the full-fat workstation chips, you know, the ones with more PCIe, twice the memory bandwidth, and professional features like better security, I'm just not really sure if I see the place for this anymore, unless you're just a big AMD fanboy and you're looking for an excuse to give them more of your money, but not quite that much of your money. It is possible that we're gonna see AMD get more competitive with pricing with these things when and if Intel ever gets their act together, but for the time being, what kind of conclusion can I draw here? I don't like it, but when you're the only car on the track, you get to win both the first place trophy and the participation ribbon. Ooh, and I got this ribbon for participating in this segue to our sponsor. Next ago, they Nexi went the whole nine yards for their Black Friday sale. From November 20th to 30th, you can get incredible deals on projectors, controllers, webcams, and more. For example, you can dive into a world of entertainment with $500 off the Aurora Pro 4K projector and save up to 36% on their PJ20 and PJ40 projectors. Or you can save up to $1,800 on the Aurora Pro bundle, which includes a Fresnel screen and a pair of 3D glasses. If you work from home and you're tired of looking like your video is being fed through a paper straw, Nexigo's Hello Cam, N970P, and Iris webcam are available at historically low prices of up to 35% off. And for the gamers, their NS32 and NS45 Switch controllers will be more affordable and stylish than ever. So don't miss out, check out all the incredible deals from Nexigo's Black Friday sale at the link down below. Before you point it out in the comments, by the way, guys, I did have a little rant about how AMD and Intel now both have a 7000 series of HEDT processors, and AMD even managed to overlap on exact model names, but we decided to spare you guys. If you liked this video, why not check out our holy on AMD's 128-core Epic Bergamo CPU. That thing was also nuts, but in some ways, Threadripper, kind of nuttier. It's clocked so much higher.